So children, let's study about the post-pollination stages. So before going to that, I just want you to summarize what we had learned in the previous class about the formation of the female gametophyte, which will be helpful for you to understand the pollination stages, post-pollination stage. So we had studied that the megaspore mother cell or MMC, that is actually deployed in nature. Be very careful. It is deployed in nature, it undergoes meiotic division to form four megaspore. First it will form the megaspore dyad, and later it forms the megaspore tetrad. And this is all meiotic division. So here what happened, out of the four haploid cells, three will degenerate and only one will survive. Only when one megaspore mother cell survives. And here what happened, this is the megaspore. And surviving megaspore, it grows, nourished by the nucleus, and from here it is the mitotic division. It divides mitotically to form two cell. It is free nuclear, it doesn't form a cell wall after that. And then again it undergoes mitotic division to form four cells, and again it undergoes mitotic divisions to form eight cells. So all these are mitotic division, but here it is meiotic or reduction division. And here once the eight cell is formed, there is a cell wall formation. So it leads to the seven nucleate, that is seven celled embryo sac, but actually, and here it will be eight nucleus. Here you can see this is the chalazal end, this is the micropylar end. At the chalazal ends, three cells will be grouped together. They are known as antipodal cells. And at the micropylar end, three cells will be grouped into a egg apparatus. And then here, in the egg apparatus, two are synergids and middle one, it is the ovum or the female gamete. This is the central cell. In the central cell, there is no wall formation. The cells are free and we call that as two polar nuclei. So totally there are eight nucleus, but it is actually seven cells. There is no cell wall formation formed in the central cell. Then what about the ploidy of these? Here, the three antipodal cells, the polar nuclei, and the two synergids and egg cell all are haploid in nature because they are formed as a result of mitosis from the megaspore. And then later, that is when the embryo sac becomes mature for the fertilization, the two polar nuclei fuses to form one diploid nuclei. So what happened? So in a mature embryo sac, the six cells are haploid and one cell is diploid. So be very careful, questions will be asked on this. So just before fertilization, seven nuclei are present and six are haploid, and this in the middle, it is diploid in nature. That is a polar nuclei, two polar nuclei will fuse to form diploid nucleus in the center, right? Next, we can also summarize what you have learnt in the microsporogenesis. So this is a combined diagram for you to understand. First, see the microsporogenesis, which you have already learned, formation of the male gamete. This is the anther lobe. So anther lobe, it is a pollen sac consisting of the microsporangium. And here also, again, what happened? The megasporocyte is there, which is again diploid in nature. This microsporocyte, it undergoes meiotic division to form a tetrad. Tetrad state in which to form four microspore. It is a reduction division, so it is haploid in nature. And each of the four microspore, it will not degenerate as in megaspore. So all the four microspore, it will undergo the mitotic division later, and then it will lead to the formation of male gametophyte. The male gametophyte is nothing but it has an outer layer known as exyne and the inner layer known as intyne. And inside there are two cells. One is generative cell and other one is vegetative cell. Vegetative cell is the one which we are going to learn, that is it is the cell of the tube cell. It helps the pollen tube when the pollen tube generates on the stigma, it helps the male gamete to enter into the ovary. And then here this exyne, you know that it is covered by a chemical that is known as sporopollenin. It's an organic compound and it can withstand high temperature and strong acid. So mainly what happened, the male gamete can be, that is pollen grains can be preserved very well as a fossil. So this is very, very strong chemical which covers the male gametophyte or the pollen grain. So again, the megasporogenesis, what we have learned was this is the megasporangium. So megasporocyte all are diploid in nature. Nucellus is also diploid in nature. Okay, so megaspore mother cell, MMC, nucellus, all are diploid, and it undergoes meiotic division to form the megaspore. So only one megaspore will survive, three will degenerate. So that is formed due to meiosis. So it is haploid in nature. And then I told you the arrangement of all the cell. So antipodals are haploid, two polar nuclei in the center are haploid, one egg cell is haploid, and two synergids are haploid. So this is the both, you can see the side by side, you can refer what is microsporogenesis and megasporogenesis. This is the formation of male gametophyte, this is the formation of the female gametophyte or the embryo sac. So be very thorough with which are the cells present in the embryo sac and their ploidy. So I told you only at maturity the embryo sac, the polar nuclei, two polar nuclei will fuse to form a diploid nucleus there. Then let's see, again this is what I had already told you, that is, this is the pollen grain, the generative nucleus or the vegetative nucleus, or it is known as a tube nucleus, which helps to grow inside the ovary. So this is binucleate pollen grain, and this is the pollen grain. Here also, you know, one the exine, there is a place where sporopollenin is not covered, that is a germ pore. So it is the germ pore, this side, from where the pollen tube germinates once it lands onto the stigma. And sometimes the pollen grain are dehiced or shed at this two cell stage, okay, having one male gamete and the tube cell. But what happens after in some plants, the pollen grains will, the male gamete will divide into two to form two sperm nuclei. That is when the pollen tube germinates into the style. That time the male gamete will divide to give two male gametes. Please understand that. And this is a tube nucleus, which will help the male gamete to enter towards the ovary. This I've already told you, just for you to revise, which are the cells of the embryo sac. Now, what are the post-pollination stages? Look at the diagram. There are many pollen grains which has been trapped by the stigma. Stigma is sticky and the pollen grains are also sticky. So out of the so many pollen grains, many will degenerate. It is due to the chemical which is produced by the stigma. And the only one out of that will grow the pollen tube. So the tube nucleus, I told you, it will grow the pollen tube. It will lead the male gametes into the ovary. So it grows here, the chemical present into that, it grows from the stigma through the style and it enters the ovary through which end? Micropylar end. Okay, and here what happened, the male gamete, when it is entering into that, before, the male gamete divides into two male gametes, two nucleus will be formed. And then once the male gamete, that is the, it enters the ovary, the tube cell degenerates, tube nucleus degenerates, because it is, the function is only to lead the pollen tube into the ovary. So once it enters over here, that is the chemical which is present, the filiform apparatus which is present in the synergid, the function of filiform thickening in the synergid, that is, this is the egg apparatus, the filiform thickening which on the synergid, it guides the male gamete into the egg. And so one of the male gamete enters the egg nucleus and other will go and it will enter into the polar nuclei. So that fertilization happens, which you'll be learning in detail in the next class. That is, after pollination, what are the stages in the fertilization? Then we had studied about the artificial hybridization. So in order to have a good hybrid, the quality of the seed and all, as we had learnt in the plant breeding chapter, there are artificial hybridization is carried out to prevent self-pollination and in order to have variety of plants. It is also in the crop also and also in the floriculture to develop different hybrids of flowers and all, different varieties of flowers, colorful flowers, all this one is helpful. So in artificial hybridization, mainly it is to prevent self-pollination. And then here you can see that there are some steps. So first one of the, this is the one of the very important crop improvement program. In such crossing improvement, that is main thing is the anther of the same flower should not pollinate the stigma of the same flower. So what is the main thing is, so for to prevent the pollen grain from pollinating, the male reproductive part is removed from the flower by with the help of a forceps. That is this image, you can see the first image which is shown over here. It is removed by the help of a forceps, and this step is known as emasculation. Once the female reproductive part is removed, what happened? It is bagged by a polythene or a butter paper for to prevent the stigma from being contaminated by any other pollen grain. Okay, and then what happened? The receptive, the compatible pollen which is needed, or it is collected from the pollen bank, which is preserved for this pollination, it is collected, and then it is dusted onto the stigma. And then that is the bag is removed, and the pollen grains from here, the compatible pollen grains are dusted onto the stigma of the flower, and again it is rebagged to prevent further contamination. And then what happened after that? It is again bagged, rebagged, and then covered and left, and then finally screening process is run to check the quality of the seed. So this is the main mechanism which is carried out in artificial hybridization, and it is in bisexual flowers or hermaphrodite flowers. This step is not needed. This method is not needed when the plants produce unisexual flowers. So unisexual flowers have its own barriers to prevent self-pollination. I hope you have understood this much. So please go through the video and then understand the concept very well. Thank you. So, good morning children. So, we'll continue with the chapter Sexual Reproduction in Flowering Plants. In the previous class, we had discussed about the pollination, how the pollen grain falls onto the stigma, then it grows the pollen tube, and pollen tube grows from stigma, then it enters the style, and then it enters the ovary at the lower end of the gynoecium. And in the ovary below, that is inside the ovary, is the ovule. So, the pollen tube, it first will be one gamete, and later there are, it divides into two mitotically to form two gametes, two male gametes, and it enters the ovule, and it enters the ovule through the apparatus known as, that is synergids. And synergids have certain thickenings, okay, that is known as filiform apparatus or filiform thickenings. The main function of filiform thickenings or filiform apparatus is to guide the pollen tube, to guide the pollen tube into the ovule. And once after that stage, what happens? The synergids, it degenerates. Now look at this first diagram here. So let's now study about the post-pollination stages. What happens inside the ovule or in the embryo sac? So in the embryo sac, what happened? Once the pollen tube enters, this is the microphyllar end, this is the chalazal end. In the chalazal end, you have the antipodals here. First, what happened here? These are the synergids, the pollen, the male gamete, which is there, which is transferred from the pollen grain to the pollen tube, it enters, and then it comes and it fertilizes the egg, and it leads to the formation of zygote. So, the ploidy of male gamete is, it is haploid, and whereas the ploidy of the egg cell is also haploid. So the ploidy of the zygote will be diploid in nature to end. And as I told you, in the organization of an embryo sac, the synergids, the egg cells, the antipodals, all are haploid. And in the center, we have studied about the polar nuclei. Each polar nuclei is haploid. But during maturity, what happened? Two polar nuclei fuses to form diploid polar nuclei. So, out of the two male gamete, one of the male gamete enters the synergid, it combines with the egg to form the zygote, that is diploid in nature. So, the combination, the fusion of the male gamete with the egg is known as syngamy, and it leads to the production of a zygote which is diploid in nature. The other male gamete, it passes through the synergid and it enters the central cell, there is the polar nuclei which has fused to form diploid polar nuclei. So one of the male gamete comes and it fertilizes the polar nuclei which is diploid, and then what happened? The male gamete, the ploidy is haploid and the polar nuclei is diploid. So the male gamete, one fuses with the egg cell, the other male gamete fuses with the
polar nuclei and it leads to the formation of primary endosperm nucleus or PEN. Now, can you tell what will be the ploidy of primary endosperm nucleus? The ploidy of primary endosperm nucleus will be, that is, male gamete. It is haploid in nature. The egg cell is also haploid in nature, and that is in the case of zygote what we have learned, diploid it is formed. And here what happened, the male gamete, one of the male gamete is haploid, it fuses with the polar nuclei. It fuses with the polar nuclei, which is diploid in nature. And these two on fusion, it leads to the formation of primary endosperm nucleus, that is triploid in nature. So, this fusion of a male gamete with the polar nuclei to form a triploid primary endosperm nucleus is known as triple fusion, because three haploid nuclei, they are fusing together. Two polar nuclei is fusing with one male gamete. So, this is known as triple fusion. So, first one syngamy and second one triple fusion takes place inside the embryo sac. Okay, so this both process, that is the fusion of male gamete with the egg cell to form a zygote and fusion of another male gamete with the polar nuclei to form primary endosperm nucleus, happens simultaneously. So, this process is known as double fertilization. This is the important characteristic features of all angiosperm. In most of the angiosperm, this is the important feature. It shows double fertilization. So, there are, and in this double fertilization, there are two male gametes which is participating in the fertilization. One is with the egg cell to form zygote, other is fusing with the polar nuclei to form primary endosperm nucleus. Once the fertilization, the fusion has happened, what happened? The antipodals which were present, that is the main purpose is for giving the nourishment to the ovum. So they start degenerating. Similarly, that is the chalazolite. This is a micropylarite. The micropylarite along with the egg, you have this egg apparatus, along with the egg, there are two synergids which are present. So synergids which had the filiform thickening. So all that starts degenerating once the fertilization has happened. So the fusion of one male gamete with a zygote to give a diploid egg cell to form zygote, which is diploid, and fusion of another male gamete with the polar nuclei to form primary endosperm nucleus. These two all together, it is known as double fertilization. Now, how the questions can be asked in this is, they might give the, that is a chromosome present. Suppose in the rice, the meiocyte, the rice has suppose 24 chromosomes in it, that is diploid. So what will be the, that is ploidy of endosperm of that nucleus? Hope you are able to understand. Rice, meiocyte, if it has 24 chromosome in it, what will be the ploidy of primary endosperm nucleus? So how you can calculate it? So this is the microspore mother cell which is diploid in nature. It forms the male gamete. So 24, that is haploid in nature. So how many it will become? 12. And then I told you all the cells in the embryo sac is haploid in nature. So you have two polar nuclei. So two polar nuclei, 12 plus 12. They are haploid in nature plus the haploid male gamete. Add it up. So what will be the ploidy? So it will be 36 chromosomes will be present in primary endosperm nucleus. That is how you have to calculate. So this kind of questions can be asked. The chromosome of rice or some other plant, suppose in maize there are 16 chromosomes. So how will you find out? If there are 16 diploid chromosomes in a maize, what will be the ploidy of the primary endosperm nucleus? So what is half of 16? So this is a diploid the chromosome present in the plant, and then half of this ploidy it will be 8. And then here how many nucleus is there? 3 haploid nucleus, 2 polar nuclei plus you have one male. So 8 into 3. So how many chromosomes will be present in PEN? It will be 24. So that is how you have to calculate it. So questions based on this will be asked. So it's very, very important. You have to learn the ploidy of each cell of an embryo cell. What is the ploidy of microspore mother cell? Microspore mother cell, it is diploid. Megaspore mother cell is diploid. And the micro, that is the male gamete and all, are haploid in nature. Egg cell is haploid, synergid is haploid. And also you have the antipodals, all are haploid in nature. Now, after this, let's study after the fertilization, post-fertilization stages. So that we are going to study. So children, this I told you, that is a fertilization. We studied about double fertilization. Now let's study what happens post-fertilization. What are the structures of the embryo and what are the events, what is taking place after fertilization. Now what happened? I told you in the this one, picture in, after the fertilization, the synergids degenerate and the antipodals degenerate. Then what happened here, that is primary endosperm nucleus. The primary endosperm nucleus, it will undergo rapid, that is mitotic division. And what is the ploidy of primary endosperm nucleus? It is triploid, 3N. That is two polar nuclei plus male gamete. So please remember, it is triploid in nature. And after the fertilization, first what happened? There are few stages which is happening post-fertilization. One is nothing but the development of the from the primary endosperm nucleus, endosperm will be formed, first stage. Second stage is nothing but the formation of, that is embryo, from the zygote. Third stage, that is from the ovule, seeds are formed. And next what happened, the ovary, that is ovary will give rise to the fruit. So these are the four developmental stages, post-fertilization events, what is happening in angiosperms. So first let's see how the endosperm is formed from primary endosperm nucleus. Now the primary endosperm nucleus, what happened after fertilization, it will undergo free nuclear division. Triploid nucleus, it divides freely, that means there won't be any cell wall formation, there is no cytokinesis. So it will undergo many mitotic divisions, many thousands of cells will be formed here. And formation of endosperm precedes the development of embryo. Do you know why? Because the endosperm provides nourishment, nutrition to the developing embryo. So that is why first endosperm is formed, then only the embryo develops from the zygote. So here you can see, that is the first there will be free nuclear division. So it is free nuclear endosperm is formed. Later what happened, from the periphery of it, the cell starts forming from the outside towards inside. So it is known as cellular endosperm, or many cells will be formed, so it will give rise to multicellular endosperm. So during the endosperm formation, there is free nuclear endosperm formed first, and next one it will be multicellular endosperm which is formed. So that is how the endosperm is formed from the primary endosperm nucleus. So this is the primary endosperm cell, PEC, and here first and the main purpose of endosperm formation is it provides nourishment to the developing embryo. Right. So next let's see the second stage after, that is post-fertilization, that is development of embryo. So I have drawn some diagrams over here. So let's see that one by one. So this is the zygote. You know zygote, what is the ploidy? It is diploid in nature, 2N. It is formed by the combination of fusion of a male gamete and a female gamete to form diploid zygote. Now how the division happens? The diploid zygotes undergo asymmetric mitotic division. Asymmetric means the cells are of not equal size, they are of unequal size. You have a large apical cell and a small cell full with cytoplasm. And then what happened here, this cell, the basal cell, what happened? It starts dividing many times and then it forms a transverse division, then it undergoes vertical division to form a long chain of cells. They are known as suspensor. The zygote, it will undergo, first it will form two cells and then it will form a suspensor. The first cell of the suspensor is known as haustorium. The first cell of the suspensor is known as haustorium. We are studying now the development of the embryo. That is in dicots, where two cotyledons are present. Okay, and here the first cell of the suspensor is known as haustorium, and the last cell is known as hypophysis. And hypophysis, what is the function? It later gives rise to radical in the, that is a growing plant. And then here what happened, after the suspensor is formed, the remaining cell divides many times, giving rise to a globular structure. So this stage of the structure is known, the embryo is known as globular embryo. First is zygote, then two cell zygote, apical cell and basal cell, and then it will undergo rapid division to form a suspensor, and then towards the base it forms like a globular embryo. So this is the globular embryo stage, this is the pro-embryo stage. Then later, I told you the first cell of the suspensor is haustorium, second cell, the last cell of that is known as hypophysis, which later give rise to radical. And here you can see the developing cotyledon. This, the shape of this is heart shape. So this is known as heart shape embryo. Okay, globular embryo and heart shape embryo. And then, and all these are diploid in nature. Next one is nothing but what happened here. This will develop, it will undergo more cellular deletions, and the upper part of the heart shape, that is when it elongates more, so hypophysis will give rise to radical, that is the, it is a future root system of the plant. And then you can see here these two structure, it will start developing. These are nothing but cotyledons. So since it's a dicot plant, so you will be having two cotyledon. So two cotyledon over here, radical, which will give rise to the root system. And in the middle, you can see over here between the cotyledon, there is a small foliar-like structure which is covered, that is the plumule. So what is the function of plumule? Plumule is nothing but it gives rise to the future shoot system. There are a lot of meristematic issues which are present over here. So it divides many times and then it will be continuous division. Okay? And then it mitosis division and leads to the growth of the embryo. So these are the different stage. So first we had seen what happens in the fertilization, that is a double fertilization, triple fusion, and then we had seen here syngamy, the ploidy of zygote is 2N, the ploidy of primary endosperm nucleus is triploidy nature. Many questions will be asked on based on this, what is the ploidy of the endosperm in the chromosome of the that rice plant or maize plant is given. So I hope you can calculate the ploidy of the endosperm of that particular plant. Then these are the developmental stages of embryo. Before that I told you the development of endosperm. Endosperm happens, the development of primary endosperm nucleus to endosperm happens before the this one, embryo is formed, because it gives the nourishment to the embryo. This is a pro-embryo stage where asymmetric mitotic division happens, and then finally what happened? The apical cell and the basal cell. The basal cell will divide many times, it will give rise to the suspensor. This is on the chalazar end, this is on to the micropylar end. And here, the lower end of that, it divides again to give a globular shape. This is known as globular embryo. Later, further, again it undergoes division and then it gives rise to the heart-shaped embryo. And the first cell of the suspensor is haustorium. The last cell is hypophysis, which is a future radical. And this is the mature embryo. Okay, this last diagram is nothing but structure of a mature embryo. So the labeling is very important. This comes under the label diagram for 3 marks. The structure will be, the diagram will be given to you, and you have to label and identify the part of the embryo, and then you have to tell what is the function of each. So this is a suspensor over here, radical, plumule, and two cotyledons. So this is the structure of a mature embryo. Hope you have understood so much. Now you can see the slide and you can understand it a little bit more better.